now waging political battles online. Recently, Ray Suarez looked at how Democrats are harnessing the power of new and social media. Republicans are his focus in part two.
If the Republicans win this fall,
Republicans and their allies are stepping up efforts to use new and social media to enhance their chances of making a comeback in the fall elections.
We're also going to be launching a social networking site.
You can find out all about it at onlinetaxrevolt.com.
Tell your groups about it, blog about it, and help us start this movement.
To this end, each week, bloggers pack a room at the conservative think tank, the Heritage Foundation, and stand up and share how they're pushing out their message, often bypassing the mainstream media.
This is the standard elite inside the Beltway worldview.
On this day, former Republican Speaker of the House Newt Gingrich addressed the new media mavens trying to regain power now. Gingrich says new media used to be a young person's business, but not anymore. He himself has 1.3 million followers on Twitter and garnered 2.3 million views on YouTube for a speech.
It allows a kind of conversation, a little bit strident, a little bit choppy, but nonetheless a real conversation that's a lot more than a 20-second soundbite or a two-minute story. We advise every candidate to have as big a budget for new media as you have for radio and television.
Some bloggers tweeted out his message, getting instant traction in the blogosphere.
I know there was live streaming happening, so I was watching somebody who's literally sitting on a beach in California paying attention to what's happening right here.
Tabitha Hale is interactive media coordinator for Freedom Works, which advocates lower taxes and less government.
I think it's something that candidates will overlook at their own peril. I think that the Republicans got killed with it in 2008. I think that we got really behind the ball, and they're figuring it out now. They're learning. I think we've made great strides in the past year.
In fact, two recent studies show on Capitol Hill, Republicans have surpassed Democrats in the use of social media. A Congressional Research Service study out this winter showed that 60% of the Capitol Hill Twitterverse is composed of Republican members. Another recent study, The Power of Twitter in Congress, shows House Republicans sending close to five times as many tweets, or micro-messages, than their Democratic counterparts. In the Senate, Republican tweets outnumbered Democrats by a 35% margin.
They knew they oversold the stimulus.
And according to YouTube, 89% of congressional Republicans have their own personal YouTube channels where they post both serious and fun videos of their professional and personal lives for constituents to see. Democrats have used this social media vehicle less. 74% have designated channels. And 8 of the top 10 most viewed and subscribed channels are from the GOP. The Washington Post's Dave Weigel covers conservative groups and their use of new media. He says the party out of power has more to protest.
It's a perfect storm because just as the Republican Party is as the base is as angry as it's ever been, there's new technology that lets them blow past the media filters. The new technology that was not invented by conservatives is stuff like Twitter, like Facebook, and other social networks. YouTube, where you can go to a rally and put it online, and it's as if it was on TV. It's video that is no longer controlled by the media that you didn't trust.
While reaching out can be positive, there are consequences of being always on, always out there, says Darrell West, the Vice President of Governance Studies at the Brookings Institution.
There are definite pitfalls to governance. A lot of the messages that get communicated are trivial. They're not very substantive. Many of the reactions are polarizing or very partisan. Sometimes social media has empowered extreme viewpoints in American politics. That makes it much more difficult to deliberate calmly on matters of major national importance. Noise does not equal representativeness. The typical social media user is more white, higher income, and better educated. And so it is definitely not the typical American. It is a small slice of America.
But true believers, such as Facebook's Adam Connor, say that slice of America is widening every day. He's been training members and their staffs since he joined Facebook 2.5 years ago, and 300 members of Congress are now using Facebook for official purposes.
I often use the analogy that these conversations are not new. People have always talked politics around the water cooler, at the office, over the backyard fence. And in the same way, people are always talking about these things online. And if you are not there and able to put your perspective and your official voice out there, then you're not part of the conversation. And I think what you would not want to do is not be part of the conversation.
Republican Congressman Robert Goodlatte is a co-chair of the Congressional Internet Caucus.
I think that we have a long way to go in terms of fully understanding how well we can reach people about our ideas and activities and events and so on, and how inexpensive compared to, you know, mailing a postcard or mailing a newsletter, how inexpensively you can reach large numbers of people by using new media. But you got to do it in a way that is of interest to them, because they have so many more alternative sources of information than they might have had 20 years ago.
At the annual George Washington University Politics Online Conference in Washington, political operatives tried to ensure that new media will grab voters in seminars such as Holy Apps, How Will Augmented Reality, GPS, and Other Smart Apps Be Used in the 2010 Election. Rod Martin is a Republican activist and former senior advisor to PayPal, an e-commerce business. He now is readying what he calls a Republican answer to the left-leaning MoveOn.org.
We want to be able to come in and enable really powerful conservative activism, and eventually when they trust us and we've earned their trust, we know they'll hand us $5 or $10 or $25. And a few million people doing that, it adds up.
And augmented reality, I believe, has the most potential to be a persuasive medium.
And Matt Lira, the new media advisor to House Minority Whip Eric Cantor, weighed in on what's being called augmented reality, which would allow voters to point a mobile device at a certain environment to reveal relevant data about that environment on the screen, soliciting the voters' opinions.
All this technology to restructure the relationship between the government and the constituents, I think it could be a radical transformation, no less impactful than when television began to impact that relationship.
Rob Willington, who did the surprisingly successful new media campaign for Senator Scott Brown, talked about 2010 techniques.
We're going to see more of a lot of people just doing a little bit in their spare time. Online donations, I think, are going to be moving towards mobile donations. We're going to see the iPhone and also the iPad be used at political events.
The effect of this new media and social media push on the Republican Party in the coming midterm elections is not clear, West says.
Sometimes people become technology determinists. They think technology solves everything. Marshall McLuhan was famous for saying it's the medium and not the message, but people need to keep in mind it still is the message. It's the content and the timing of what they say that affects the national debate. And so people should not get confused by the nature of the platform.
Yet another push on new media is coming in the form of a growing number of conservative-backed startup online news organizations around the country. They're focusing coverage on government and politics at a time when newspapers are cutting back. Tom Rosensteel heads Pew's Project for Excellence in Journalism.
I think there are important questions to ask about anybody who represents themselves as a news organization. One of them is, what is the financing? Another is, what's the intent? Is it to spark public discussion, or is it to forge certain outcomes?
There's no sign that any of the forms of new media will slow down. As Republicans push toward gains in 2010, the GOP leadership recently declared Twitter Day on Capitol Hill.